Okay, part two of this.
I have water.
Well, just a little bit of water. And there it goes.
I don't think I have any water.
My really old ones. As I look over Max, his wounds and welds provide a play-by-play of his last brutal fight, one of the most violent I've ever seen. Berkeley team that lost will be starting from scratch. By the end of the bout, Max had to drag himself across the arena with one arm he had left before pummeling his incapacitated opponent into metal shavings. When the victory gun sounded, we had to do a remote kill to shut him down. That way, the way that he was twitching, someone would have gotten hurt trying to get close enough to shout over the screeches of grinding and twisted metal. The slick of oil from the bout took 2 hours to mop up before the next one could start. "You look good," I tell Max. This is my way of complimenting Peter's repair work without complimenting Peter directly. Jeannie joins us as I lift Max's pincers from the workbench. "Let me give you a hand," I tell Max. An old joke between us. I swear his arm twitches as I say this. I left the pincher attachment toward the stub of his forearm. But before I could get it attached, Max's arm slides gently out of the way. "See?" Peter says. I barely hear him. My pulse is pounding. Something between surprise and anger. It's a shameful feeling. One I recognize from being a mom. It's all the sudden lack of compliance from a person who normally does what they're told. It's a rejection of my authority. "Max, don't move," I say. The arm freezes. I lift the pincher toward the attachment again. His arm jitters away from me. "Shut him down," I said, "Peter." Jeannie is getting closer, and he hits the red shutoff. But it's not before Max starts to say something. Before words can even form, his camera's iris shuts and his arm sags to his side. "The next bit will really piss you off," Peter says. He grabbed the buzzsaw and attached it to Max's left arm while I clicked the pinches to the right and reached for the power. "I might want to stand back first," Jeannie warns. I take a step back before hitting the power. Max whirs to life and does just what Peter described in the car. He detaches both his arms, the attachment slammed to the ground, and the pincer attachment rolls toward my feet. Before I can ask Max what the hell he's doing, before I can get to the monitors and see what line of code, what routine just ran, he does something even crazier than jettisoning his attachment. "I'm sorry," he says. The fucker knows he's doing something wrong. "It's not the safety overrides," I say. "Nope." Jeannie has his head over his hands. We've been going over the possibilities for 2 hours. 2 hours for me. The boys have been at this for nearly 12. I cycle through the code Max has been running, and none of it makes sense. He's got tactical routines and defense modules engaging amid all the clutter of the parallel processors. But he's hard set into maintenance mode. Those routines shouldn't be firing at all. And I can see why Peter warned me not to put any live fire attachments on. The last thing we need is Max shooting up $4 million trailer. Oh, that's good. "I've got it," I say. It's at least the 20th time I've said this. This boy has shot me down every time. The boys have shot me down every time. It's a hack. The SoCal team knows they're getting stomped in 2 days. They did this. If they did, they're smarter than me, Jeannie says. And they aren't smarter than me. "We looked for any foreign code," Peter says. "Every diagnostic tool in the virus check comes back clean." We looked up at Max, who's watching us. We tried to figure out what's wrong with him. I project too much to the guy, read into his body language, whatever. I'm feeling or whatever I expect him to feel. Right now, I imagine him as being sad. Like he knows he's disappointing me. But to someone else, a stranger, he probably looks like a mechanic, menacing hulk of a destroyer. 8 feet tall, angled steel, pistons for joints, pockmark armor. We see what we expect to see, I guess. "Max, Why won't you hold up your hand? Why won't you keep your hands on? I asked him. Between the three of us, we've asked him variations of this 100 times. I don't want them there, he says. It's useful as a kid saying they want chocolate because they like chocolate. Circular reasoning is the tightest of loops. But why don't you want them? I asked. I just don't want them there. It's not circular reasoning. That's just my whole thing. He's just not telling him why he doesn't want them there. Maybe he wants them up his ass, Genie suggests. He fumbles for his vape and has switched to peppermint. I honestly don't know how the boys are still functioning. We aren't in the 30s or 20s or 30s anymore. All-nighters take their toll. I think we should shut him down and go over everything mechanical one more time, I said, utterly defeated. Worst case scenario, we do a wipe and reinstall tomorrow before the finals. Max's primary camera swivels toward me, at least I think it does. Peter shoots Genie a look, and Genie lifts his head and shifts uncomfortably on his stool. Why aren't you telling me? I asked. Peter looked terrified. Max is watching us. You didn't get a dump yesterday, did you? I have to turn away from Peter and pace the length of the trailer. There's a rumble outside of our upcoming opponent as our upcoming opponent puts through his paces in the arena. Boy, would SoCal guys love to know what a colossal fuck-up we have going on here. So we've lost all the data from yesterday's bouts. I try to calm down. Maintain perspective. Keep a clear head. We've got a good dump in the semis. From the semis, I said. We can go back to that build. Turning back to the boys, I see all three of them standing perfectly still. The robot and the two engineers watching us. So, we lost one bout of data, I say. He's good enough to win. The Chinese were favorites anyway, and they're out. Nobody says anything. I wonder if this is about ego or pride. Engineers hate wipes and reinstalls. It's a last resort, and in minutes of defeat. A dreaded cry of reboot. Which is to say, we have no clue, and hopefully the issue will sort itself out and start over if we clear the cache. That seems odd, because it seems like anybody who's ever worked in tech knows reboots and reinstalls are, like, pretty much the greatest way to cure any problem. I guess it would mean that you fail, but I feel like the first thing anyone does that works with computers, software of any kind, is reboot the computer. But I guess they did turn it on and off, didn't they? Reinstalls are definitely different, and that's a huge pain in the ass, because you gotta reinstall fucking everything. Okay, moving on. Are you sure you can't think of anything else that might be wrong with him? Peter asks. He and Genie join me at the other end of the trailer. Again, that weird look on their faces. It's more than exhaustion. It's kind of wonder and fear. What do you know that you're not telling me? I ask. It's what we think, Genie says. Fucking tell me, Jesus Christ! We need a clear head to look at this, Peter says. Another set of eyes. He glances at Genie. If she doesn't see it, then maybe we're wrong. But I do see it. Right then, like a lightning bolt straight up my spine. One of those thoughts that falls like a sledgehammer and gives you a mental limp for the rest of your life. And that changes how you walk and how you see the world. Hell no, I say. The boys say nothing. Max seems to twitch uncomfortably at the far end of the trailer. And I don't think I'm projecting this time.